Well, students, we are almost reaching the last part of this chapter on fiber optics. Before we go into the applications, one last small parameter about the fiber, something called as a V number, also called as a normalized frequency. Now, what is this V number or normalized frequency? It is a formula. There's no derivation for this formula, but you need to know it for the sake of problems and all. And also, it's what is the meaning of this V number? You also have to know significance. So, what is V number? The formula is 2 pi a upon lambda into root of mu 1 square minus mu 2 square. Okay. Now, where a is what? A is the radius of the core, not diameter, please note. A here is the radius of the core. Lambda is the wavelength of light which is passing through the fiber, wavelength of the light propagating through the fiber. Mu 1 and mu 2, they are the, mu 1 is the refractive index of the core and mu 2 is the refractive index of the cladding. Now, we know that this part here, mu 1 square minus mu 2 square is nothing but the, is also the numerical aperture. If you see the formula for numerical aperture, where's the formula? Here. Numerical aperture is root of mu 1 square minus mu 2 square upon mu 0. Now, assuming that the surrounding medium is air, then mu 0 will be equal to 1. And then numerical aperture will be just root of mu 1 square minus mu 2 square. So, if you look in this formula for V number, we have over here root of mu 1 square minus mu 2 square. This is nothing but your numerical aperture, assuming that the surrounding medium is air. Okay, so both these are the same formulas representing the same quantity V number. Now, what is the significance of this normalized frequency or V number? So, if V number is high or V number is low, what does it tell us about the fiber? So, V number, normalized frequency, the significance is that V number is an indicator of how many modes the fiber will support. So, if the V number of the fiber is higher, it means that the fiber will support more number of modes. Okay. So, if you put all these values of A, lambda and mu 1, mu 2 and calculate the value of V, and suppose V comes out to be a large number, what does it tell you? That the fiber will support many modes. Okay. So, how many modes the fiber will support based on V number, you can calculate it by approximately by this formula. So, number of modes the fiber will support for a step index fiber. There are two different separate formulas for step index and green fiber. So, for a step index fiber, if the number of modes the fiber will support is approximately V square by 2. So, you calculate the value of V based on these parameters for the fiber and then use this formula V square by 2. This is will tell you how many modes the given step index fiber will support. And for a green fiber, if the fiber is a green fiber, graded index fiber, then the formula is not V square by 2, but it is number of modes supported is V square by 4. For example, suppose the fiber is given a step index fiber and after all this putting all the values of core size and all this thing, mu 1, mu 2, suppose the value of V comes out to be 10. Then how many modes that given step index fiber will support? So 10 square by 2, so 100 by 2, so 50 modes. The fiber will support 50 modes of propagation. If the same fiber was given as a green fiber, then it would have been V square by 4. So V square, 10 square will be 100 by 4 would have been 25. So only 25 modes the green fiber would have supported. So given the two types of fibers, step index and green fibers, step index fibers support more number of modes. But even then, green fibers are preferred for digital data communication. Why? We had seen earlier in the previous lecture, green fibers have less signal dispersion. Okay, so it's they are faithful to the signal. So whatever signal you send is received on the other end also as the same signal. The signal does not change. Okay, whereas in a step index fiber, there is the possibility of the signal changing because of the large signal dispersion occurring in the fiber. Okay, so that's about the V number. So V number tells us, based on the V number, we can calculate how many modes the fiber will support. Higher the value of V, more modes the fiber will support. The last part in this chapter is the applications of the optical fibers. So we are going to study only two applications. The first application is how to use an optical fiber in communication. This is the most important application of the optical fiber today, practical application. We know that optical fibers are used for cable networks, for transmitting of telephone lines between one exchange to the other. There's always optical fibers which are used because of lot of advantages which they have, which we'll be seeing later on. So how can we use optical fibers for the purpose of communication? Okay, so let us take an example of a voice signal. So this is a block diagram of a simple one-way communication system. So in this case, someone is speaking over here and there's a listener over here. So only this is a one-way means what? Only this person can speak and this person can listen. This person cannot speak and this person speaks, this person here will not be able to listen. So it's only a one-way. But you can always have a duplicated system, a similar type of system other way around also, and it can make it a two-way. So right now in this discussion, we'll be talking only about a one-way communication system. So what we have here, we have a sound. So it's a system wherein we are transmitting an audio signal. You can also transmit a video signal if you want. So, let us see how a sound signal can be transmitted and over a long distance and listened by a listener here, which is might be very far away or kilometers away from the person who's speaking over here. So what happens here? The person who's speaking is producing sound. This sound is converted into an electrical signal by this mic. Okay, so mic converts sound signal into electrical signal. Then the signal produced by the mic is very small. It needs to be amplified. So there's an amplifier which amplifies the signal. Then there is a modulator. Now what the modulator does, you must be knowing that there are different types of modulation, frequency modulation, amplitude modulation, pulse width modulation. What is the purpose of modulation? The purpose of modulation is, what is happens in modulation? The signal is superimposed on a high frequency carrier. The whatever signal you want, required signal is there to be transmitted. It is first superimposed on a high frequency carrier. Now what is the purpose of this modulation? So that the signal will travel, be able to travel very long distances. Whenever you want to transmit a signal over long distances, you will always modulate it over a higher frequency signal called as a carrier. So that's what the modulator does. It modulates the audio signal, this voice signal, over the high frequency carrier. And then the signal needs to be converted into digital format before transmitting it to the fiber. Okay, so there's an analog to digital converter. So this signal which is produced by the mic and amplifier, these are analog signals. Okay, so they are need to convert it into digital signal format by using a A to D converter. Then, now before transmitting this, giving the signal into optical fiber, remember optical fiber carries data only in the form of light. Now this signal is in the form of electrical signal. So we need to convert the electrical signal into light. So that is what the laser diode does. So this electrical signal is fed into a laser diode. The laser diode converts the electrical signal into a light signal. And then the light is carried by the optical fiber. Now this optical fiber could be in kilometers distance, okay, long fiber running into kilometers. Then on the other end of the fiber, the light again is converted into electrical signal using a photodiode. Okay, so this is a photodiode converting light signal into back into electricity. Then again the signal needs to be converted into analog format. So there's a digital to analog converter. Then there's a demodulator. What a demodulator does, it separates the required signal from the carrier. Carrier is not what we require. Carrier is filtered out. And only the signal required, audio signal, is allowed to carry, move on forward. Then the signal is again amplified. And then finally it is given to a loudspeaker, which produces or reproduces the sound again. So whatever sound was produced here, after traveling through this entire path over a long distance in kilometers, is finally produced back over here by the loudspeaker. So this is the way an audio signal can be transmitted in one way. And then by duplicating the same system other way around, we can make the signal two ways. Now, you can, instead of a audio signal, you can also transmit a video signal, as I had told earlier. So, only difference what you'll need to do is, this mic will have to be replaced with a camera to capture the video. And then on the other hand, instead of a speaker, you'll require to put a TV screen or a monitor over here, so as to view the signal. So, the only changing this input and output component, keeping the other thing more or less same, you can, instead of a audio signal, you can transmit a video signal. Then, the next application of a optical fiber is the fiberscope. It is an instrument, it's also called as an endoscope. It is basically an instrument which is directly used to view the internal parts of organs like the throat, the windpipe, the intestine, stomach, etc. So it's basically like you're sending a camera into the body and taking pictures or videos of the organs directly. But remember, if you just send a camera inside, you'll not be able to see anything. Why? Because it's all darkness inside. So you also need to put in light. You have to illuminate the organ first. So that is what the endoscope does. So endoscope consists of two bundles of optical fibers. So this is one bundle of optical fiber. This is another bundle of optical fiber which is joined together. This end over here is inserted into the body and kept on pushing inside through the mouth, most probably, or through the nose, or through the rectum, or through the vagina, till it reaches the organ which is to be viewed. Okay, so now what these two bundles do? One bundle of light, one bundle of the optical fiber carries light from an outside source. There's a bulb outside here. So this optical fiber picks up the light from this bulb, carries it and illuminates the organ which is to be viewed. So once the organ is illuminated, the other fiber then picks up the light reflected from the organ and it carries it outside of the body to be viewed directly with the eye, or you can take a photograph or take a video of it using a camera. Okay, so this is how the endoscope works. Two bundles of optical fibers. One bundle illuminates the organ by picking up light from an outside source. Other bundle takes up the light reflected from the organ and you can view directly with the eye. Okay, so any organ like, as I told you, stomach, lungs, intestines, internal parts of these organs can directly be photographed or videographed using this endoscope instrument. It's a very commonly used instrument today in the field of medical field. Okay, and now, the last part, we'll just discuss some few advantages of optical fibers over copper wires in communication. You must be knowing that earlier, copper wires were used for signals like phone, telephones and all. Copper wires were used. But nowadays, almost every copper wires are replaced with optical fibers. You also, in your homes, must be receiving your internet and telephones and your cable must be through optical fibers. So, how are optical fibers better than copper wires? So these are all the advantages. Optical fibers are cheaper because they are made of glass or plastic compared to copper. They are lighter also. They are smaller in size and they are stronger. Okay, so optical fibers, even though they are made of glass, optical fibers are much more stronger. Okay, you don't think that they will easily break. They are very strong. So, first thing. Second thing, optical fibers are not hazardous because they are not good conductors of electricity. So, by mistake, suppose an optical fiber comes in contact with a high voltage line, it will not cause any harm because they will not pick up the voltage from this high voltage because of they are bad conductors. But suppose a copper wire was there, and the copper wire of your telephone by mistake comes in contact with a high voltage electricity line, then you can get a shock. It can be a very dangerous situation. So in that sense, since optical fibers are bad conductors, they are not hazardous. Now, optical fibers reduce the possibility of crosstalk. Now what is this crosstalk? In the earlier times, if you remember, there was something called as cross connection. You dial one number, it ends up talking to someone else, or you can hear some background voices in the phone. So these are called as crosstalks. Now how does crosstalks used to happen? If there's a copper wires, when if the insulation of the copper wires and all goes, and if two wires come in contact, the signal from one wire can jump into the other wire. And that's how the cross connections and all take place. Okay. Now in optical fiber, this is almost a impossible thing to happen because in optical fibers, the light never comes out of the core. Okay. So your signal is within the core. So there's the possibility of crosstalk. Nowadays you see there's almost no cross connections. Okay. Because most of the copper wires are replaced with optical fibers. Then, optical fibers have a high bandwidth. They can carry huge amount of data. Okay, I told you in one of the lectures, a single optical fiber can carry data equivalent of around 1,000 telephone lines. So, 1,000 wires, copper wires, you can replace with just one single optical fiber. Okay, so very high bandwidth they have, and then they can carry light data in the form of light, and that's so therefore data travels very fast. So the speed is very high at very high speed because data is in the form of light. Optical fibers have a low loss per unit length. Why? Because they use the phenomenon of total internal reflection. Okay, so low losses means what? You require less number of repeaters, amplifier boxes in between. After traveling a certain distance, the signal has to be amplified again. Otherwise, if you keep on continuing the signal without amplifying it in between, then by the time it reaches the end point, the signal will become very low in amplitude. So you require an amplifier in between. So number of amplifiers you will require for a copper wire system is much, much higher compared to an optical fiber. Because optical fiber, the losses are less. So you can travel a longer distance before you require an amplifier in between to amplify the signal. So that's the advantage. And finally, optical fibers are not affected by radio frequency and electromagnetic. So lightning and all outside lightning, thunder occurring and all will not affect the signal in an optical fiber. Whereas we know that this type of interferences disturb or affect the signal in electrical signal flowing through a copper wire. Okay. So these are the advantages of using copper wires over using optical fibers over copper wires for the purpose of communication. Thank you. So this is the end of this chapter on optical fibers.